Welcome back to New Rockstars. I'm Erik Voss, and Joker's early reviews are in, calling the Todd Phillips Joaquin Phoenix Joker origin story an overall success, even if some of its darker elements leave us a bit unsettled. But apparently not too unsettled for the audience at the Venice Film Festival to give the film an 8-minute standing ovation. Like, I know extreme binary responses are standard at film fests, but 8 minutes? It's impossible to express pleasure for 8 minutes. 2 minutes, tops. 2 perfect minutes. I am gonna break down the major takeaways from these critics' reviews to explain what to expect as you walk into this Joker film when it premieres on October 4th, and I will not spoil anything of the movie's plot, but still, I guess spoiler warning in case any of my speculation ends up being too accurate. Okay, the main question on most of our minds is, how does Joaquin Phoenix's Joker compare to past movie Jokers we've seen? Joaquin Phoenix's performance as Arthur Fleck, the man who becomes the Joker, is being praised as the most impressive aspect of the film, with many calling it Oscar-worthy. Phoenix lost 52 pounds for the role and studied videos of patients with real neurological disorders of pathological laughter in order to make his vivid descent into madness a fascinating rise into self-actualization. IGN commented, "Arthur's uncontrollable laughter looks as though it physically pains him. His body is rail-thin and battered. His misery is etched on his deeply creased face. He looks healthier and livelier, dare I say happier, as he transforms into Joker than he ever does as Arthur." Phoenix captures all these tiny nuances in Arthur and his interactions with others that reveals so much about this disturbed individual's inner life. While Joker does present a new origin story for the character, it maintains the falseness and unreliability of the character that fans have always upheld as his true nature. Gizmodo explained, "We frequently see things happening that aren't actually happening. Information is given that isn't quite accurate. Arthur's point of view is mostly unreliable. And so the film swings you between empathy and pity, or humor and awkwardness, sometimes in a single shot." So it sounds like there's little debate over whether Phoenix's Joker is great, but does this movie represent a true Joker origin? How much is this really a DC movie? We've heard lots of rumors over these months that there's stuff about this Joker movie that might alienate some hardcore DC purists. And indeed, according to critics like Cinema Blend, the movie is, quote, entirely unconcerned with any pre-existing canon. IO9 said, "Though there are characters with the last name Wayne, and it takes place in a city called Gotham, there's little else that distinguishes Todd Phillips' latest film as a comic book movie. It's a solid, well-made film that ultimately has a bit of an identity crisis." And they go on to say that Joker is a comic book origin story with very little comic book in it. But for those of us who grew up reading these comics, what makes something comic book? Even from its beginnings, Gotham City was always envisioned as a metaphor for New York City, and the characters of Batman and the Joker were symbols of broader concepts and opposing themes like order versus chaos, vigilante justice versus terrorism, mental illness, all things that artists saw reflected in real life events. But assuming these critics are referring to comic book as the standard Marvel formula of cameos, Easter eggs, post-credit scenes, what things does this DC film explore instead? It sounds as though Todd Phillips has grounded this Joker film in realism, the way Chris Nolan did in his Dark Knight trilogy, except even further in that direction, without even any advanced military tech to wow us. Instead, a quieter character study that heavily pays homage to the early films of Martin Scorsese, like The King of Comedy and Taxi Driver. In The King of Comedy, Robert De Niro plays Rupert Pupkin, an unstable, struggling comedian who violently forces his way into a guest spot on his favorite late-night show. De Niro also played Travis Bickle in Scorsese's more famous film, Taxi Driver, a wannabe assassin who becomes a sort of sympathetic antihero by the film's end. So by casting De Niro in this film as Murray Franklin, the late-night host that Arthur Fleck is obsessed with, Phillips is not at all shy about these thematic parallels. This Joker is a symptom of societal and economic decay, a society that has abandoned those on the fringes and now must pay the price for that abandonment. According to Time Out, the film is, quote, a truly nightmarish vision of late-era capitalism, arguably the best social horror film since Get Out. Indeed, many critics have observed concepts like the conflicts between the working class and the wealthy elite, access to mental health care, bullying, gun control, news media, fame seekers using violence as a way to treat their afflictions. And those varying themes have also been the source of many of the gripes around this film, with some critics complaining that the movie doesn't do enough to outright condemn Joker's evil actions. Instead, they're saying, leaving us feeling like violence and nihilism are valid responses worth considering, in some cases celebrating. Time Magazine, who is obviously not a big fan, said Phillips may want to think he's giving us a movie all about the emptiness of our culture, but really he's just offering a prime example of it. Burn! burn. She goes on to gripe, Joker is dark only in a stupidly adolescent way, but it wants us to think it's imparting subtle political or cultural wisdom. And that review wants us to think and only use the phrase wants us to think once. Whether or not you agree with that depends on whether you need movies to answer the thematic questions that it poses. Like one could argue, The Dark Knight validated that Joker's nihilistic worldview, that the people of that Gotham actually could not be trusted not to descend into madness, forcing Batman and Gordon to commit a noble lie to protect their innocence. So does that make The Dark Knight morally irresponsible? I don't think so. It's not Hollywood's job to explain to audiences, okay, you may like Thanos, but don't go around trying to kill half of everything, okay? But then where does this Joker movie leave us? I do not know how the movie ends. I have not seen it yet. But if it does follow the stories of Taxi Driver or The King of Comedy, we may be looking at some kind of surprise validation for Arthur Fleck as a way to, like, comment on the moral decay of this society that a madman like this could inspire. Comicbook.com's Brandon Davis said, quote, Joker is loaded with mystery on top of its numerous twists. By the time it ends, viewers will be left with several questions about the experience, some of which might be scarily directed at themselves. And Gizmodo said, for a movie that's so dead set on being its own standalone thing, it sure goes out of the way to leave fans with threads that could spin off into other movies. So we might be looking at an ending that sets up a future DC Black type story that follows other rogue gallery villains and similar dark origin stories, or even an ending that connects to the upcoming Matt Reeves, Robert Pattinson, Batman. This connection could actually be the mystery comment that was accidentally spoiled by Pattinson in a recent interview that was then cryptically redacted from the article. For more on what that could be sure to watch tomorrow's episode of Rogue Theory, in which I and other hosts will pitch our wildest theories for how the Joker movie could end and set up future DC stories. Trust me, you won't want to miss it. I always do weird stuff with action figures. It's a wild time. Do you want Joker to be the standard for all DC movies going forward? Comment down below with your thoughts. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter at EA Boss, and subscribe to New Rockstars for deeper dives into everything you love. Thank you for joining me. And yes, there's weird lighting because this blue dungeon is in a new studio. And yeah, I know it's a little weird to wear a jacket this early in September, but it's a Marvel shirt. Can't wear that doing a DC video. Come on.